Okay, welcome everybody. We're at the work session for the Board of Mayor and Aldermen for Tuesday, March the 8th, 2022, and we're going to call the roll. Alderman Barnhill.
Present.
Vice Mayor Blanton.
Here.
Alderman Hanson.
Here.
Alderman Peterson.
Here.
Alderman Berger.
Present.
Alderman Brown.
Present.
Alderman Potts.
Present.
Alderman Baggett.
Present.
And I'm here too. So everybody's here tonight, fully accounted for. The next item on the agenda is citizen comments for items that are not on the agenda. If you've not been here before, the tradition is there's some speaker cards. We ask you to fill those out and give those to me if you plan on speaking. And it's a bit annoying when you bring them up halfway through the meeting or halfway through a public hearing. So I like to get them now. So, okay. And we've got that out of the way. And next is items 1 through 4, which are return events. One's the Bourbon and Bubbles. The other one's the Main Street Festival, Pumpkin Fest, and Dickens of a Christmas. So any questions about any of those? Okay, we'll continue to move on. We'll go to item 5 and 6. We'll consider it together. Ordinance 2022-02, an ordinance to rezone 0.09 acres from residential R6 district to plan PD 1800 district for property located north of West Folk Street and east of Natchez Street at 130 West Folk Street. And also we'll be looking at a development plan for the same property with one modification of standard for parking. So, Joey, how you doing?
Good. Good to see y'all. This is for a redevelopment of the site utilizing the existing building as the former Winstead Tabernacle Church that the property owner would like to repurpose into a recording studio. Preservation and rehabilitation of the existing building meets the recommendations of Envision Franklin for this area of town. There is one modification of standard for the required parking to be located across the street at the county parking lot at the county site there. It's across the street because there's no anywhere on the subject property that could accommodate the required parking. So staff is recommending approval, and it got unanimous support from Planning Commission.
Any questions? Okay, we'll continue to move on. Items 7 and 8, we'll consider those, and 9, we'll consider all those together. Ordinance 2021-05, an ordinance to rezone 233.66 acres from Agricultural District and Civic Institutional to Plan PD 2.02 District for several properties located near the intersection of Hillsborough Road and Matt Catcher Memorial Parkway, known as Brownland Farm PUD Subdivision. And the next is a development plan for Brownland Farm PUD Subdivision. And number 9 is actually the parkland impact fee for the property. So, Amy?
Yes, thanks. To jog everyone's memory, you guys saw this project at the October 12th BOMA. Well, some of you saw it at the October 12th BOMA meeting. The applicant had 5 conditions that they wanted to address. And so BOMA referred it back to Planning Commission to allow them time to incorporate those conditions into their plan, have it re-reviewed by staff, and then re-reviewed by Planning Commission. The conditions were that they had a deeded emergency access easement and improvement plans to bypass Hillsborough Road between Matcatcher Parkway and Fulton Greer Road, where the floodplain is at a certain depth. And the condition was that be provided with the first site plan. The second condition was to require a CLOMAR to be approved by FEMA prior to a grading permit. This is already a condition of the zoning ordinance, so that's a non-issue. The third condition was to limit the number of buildings to 4 units per building, and they did take off all of the multifamily buildings on their plan, and now they only have multiplexes, townhomes, duplexes, and single-family units. And that does meet Envision Franklin in terms of the use types for residential. The fourth requirement was to, or the fourth condition that they wanted to address was to remove the area from the development from the site where the existing floodplain is greater than 36 inches in depth. And this is not including the floodway and floodplain area near Hillsborough Road. They have done that with the plan. The last requirement was to reduce the total number of units to 395 units. In this plans before you, they only have 356 units. So they've met that condition that they wanted to meet. So they met all their conditions. Staff is still recommending disapproval of the plan. There is still development shown in the areas of envisioned Franklin labeled conservation. Conservation subdivision is different. That plan in that area of the site generally meets envisioned Franklin, but it doesn't meet the conservation design concept. Staff still recommending disapproval.
Question or comments from the board? I do have one public comment if you'd like to hear it first, and I do know the applicant representative is here and wants to make some comments. So, Alderman Peterson.
I just wanted to say at the Planning Commission, when we looked at this again, it was stated that those conditions were really brought by the applicant, you know.
Yes, correct. They were not BOMA conditions.
They were not BOMA.
They were requested that they be able to be incorporated. So BOMA granted them the opportunity to go back. They weren't BOMA conditions, correct?
Thank you.
And I must say that Planning Commission, when they reviewed it again, voted to disapprove this plan 6-2.
Go ahead, Alderman Berger.
Were not those conditions in response to planning what they requested? I mean, they just didn't throw up five things that they wanted, did
no,
they?
No, not necessarily.
I thought they were
one
responding.
One of them is in response to Envision Franklin. The condition that they wanted to change their building types to have no more than four units. That was in direct response to staff's point that multifamily was not supported on this site. That one condition is in direct response.
Well, I thought we were in a meeting where we were taking a second vote and we threw it all out because we found water on the road that was not acceptable, and that was not their condition. It was something our city staff found and responded and said, oh, we have a problem now. And that was after a year and a half, and so that was odd because we were at a second vote, and then so the applicant responded to that.
That is one. I apologize.
Yeah.
That one is a response to what staff found.
All right.
I think it's fair to say that it's a response to the dialogue you had in October. And it may have been from dialogue with some of the aldermen, but it ultimately was brought forward by the applicant the day of that vote, and the board said, we're going to send it back and have planning staff and planning commission review it. So it was part of the dialogue, but it was not necessarily conditions set out by the board for approval.
I didn't hear that.
Just how you characterize it.
Yeah, but I didn't hear the applicant come up and tell us that you found the water. Who found the water? I mean, who brought that before us? I mean, oh, come on. We know that it was brought to us by staff, so we had to respond to it, or we did respond to it properly. Okay, that's fine. And I don't take issue with that at all. I think, they should respond to it. Okay, I have a couple other comments, but I think I will wait because I know you all have stuff.
Any other board members want to make some comments before I
ask? I just want to, I'll wait until afterwards.
With the full five conditions, why wasn't the conservation as part of a condition also?
Ask that question again.
Well, you said it met Envision Franklin did not meet the conservation.
No, the portion. Removal of multifamily met Envision Franklin. In the conservation subdivision design concepts, the only supported uses for residential are single family, townhomes, multiplexes, and duplexes. Their plan that they showed you on October 12th had three multifamily buildings on it. So staff wasn't supporting the plan for that reason. One of the reasons was for that purpose. Does that make sense? But the plan before you today has removed the three multifamily buildings. So that aspect of the plan now meets Envision Franklin. There are other reasons why the plan still does not meet Envision Franklin today. There are large portions of this site that are labeled conservation design concept. They coincide with the floodplain. And Envision Franklin states that there should be no development in those areas. The only supported development in that area is recreation at a very passive scale. Staff bases our recommendations on Envision Franklin. So it's staff's recommendation only that this plan is not supported because they still show areas of development in conservation design concept.
So conservation is different than conservation subdivision, right? You may want to, that may be correct. Important to differentiate.
That's right.
For folks.
Sorry, we maybe should work on those names. I get it. But there are, if you looked at the map with both of the colors of Envision Franklin on there, there's a light green and a dark green. The dark green is conservation. The light green is conservation subdivision. So if they only had uses in conservation subdivision, this would most likely be a different recommendation from staff. And they have removed some development from conservation subdivision, which is one of what they wanted to do. But they haven't removed it all. So staff is still recommending disapproval.
Okay. After that explanation, any other comments from the board? Okay. Ms. Henderson, please come up, and we'll give you 2 minutes to make your comments.
The other night at the meeting, my husband...
Go ahead and give your name.
Mel Henderson, Monticello, 202 Revere Lane. The other night at the meeting, my husband and I presented some pictures, and there's a big question on site one development of the road access, emergency access. This afternoon, I spoke again with David Forbes, who is the branch manager, and he's given me permission to share with you this information. This has never been finalized. I got home that night, and I had said I had contacted the man in Memphis, who was the corporate owner. And he did have a message for me and said that that road access decision had not been made at this time. That's on my answering service at my house. The owner of the property that actually owns the property where Site 1 is located is a resident of Franklin originally, who was the Flower Power family, and he presently lives in Florida. But he introduced himself to me after the meeting, and I think Mr. Brown was there standing next to me at the time. And then Ms. Restis did come over and say, well, I need to talk to you. But it was presented at the meeting that this was condition has been met. But at this time, they have not made that decision about it. And the branch manager also gave me permission this afternoon to say that there's been some questions about all this access about being having the main road there because so much of their property is flooded, and that if they did have an access emergency entrance, they could have a huge big truck there, or they could have some other things blocking all that. So that decision has not been made. I have not been able to, Mr. Krull is out of town at this time. So, but these names have been given to the Planning Commission and to the administrative staff so that can be followed through by them. Officially, that's all I wanted to say, except that I do think the other night that the traffic issue presently, the traffic is workable. But it's like Mr. Forbes, as he said, if you add 300 and some other houses and have different cars, he said they're not looking forward to having this, any kind of emergency road access at Site 1. But that's just his opinion. And he's, you know, he doesn't make that decision at all. It's always made by the corporate person. And then, of course, the easement would have to be given by the landowner who lives here in Howard Glen. And that's not even been presented. But when it was presented, it was like this had already been presented, that this was a high-level ground here going this way, and you would come out this way and so on. But I question that, and my husband questions it also. And as a teacher, a former teacher, I would say that the schools in that area, the traffic, if you've ever been in Grassland Community at 4:30 in the afternoon, you're going to have 45 minutes to get to Franklin. You have Franklin Elementary School. Mm-hmm. You've got Walnut Grove. You've got the junior high.
Up, please.
Thank you. And that's fine. I just want you all to consider that issue of is it two lane from that time on. Thank you.
Thank you. Do you want to hear from the applicant? Okay.
Thank you, and I appreciate your time tonight. To be efficient, I've written down a few notes to read, and they're relevant to the graphics that are being passed around. My name is Greg Gamble, and I'm here tonight with John Michael, and we're representing the applicant for Brownland Farms. You've heard from, over the course of Brownland review, how staff cannot recommend approval of the master plan due to the proposed development within conservation policy. Envision Franklin is a guide to future land uses within the city, and we agree that we should strive to achieve the goals within it. The guidelines state to preserve the form, function, and character of the area of floodplain. The Brownland Master Plan does this and more. It improves the floodplain's form and function by eliminating obstructions and increasing volume. It improves the character by returning the land to a natural state and new park areas. What has not been mentioned is how we align with the zoning ordinance and the stormwater regulations. It has been misconstrued that floodplain alterations are prohibited in Franklin. The stormwater ordinance prohibits or permits floodplain alterations and requires that compensatory cut be applied at a rate of 150% for all fill in the floodplain. This regulation is a significant benefit to Franklin. As properties are developed along the Harpeth River, more storage is made available. This improves the function of the floodplain and improves the ability to hold floodwaters. It is not a negative. This first map that you're looking at here shows the location of four clomars approved by FEMA along Carruthers Parkway. It's on the left side of the first PDF, 11 by 17. Ladd Park, Water's Edge, Lockwood Glen Commercial, and New Southeast Park. The curvature of the river is very similar to the curvature at Brownland. The grading work for Ladd Park and Water's Edge raised lots above the floodplain and lowered the flood elevation 1.2 feet. This is not coincidence. This is a result of good engineering, good regulations that work for the benefit of all residents in Franklin. The zoning ordinance also allows for floodplain alterations and establishes regulations when it's proposed. It requires that a Tennessee registered professional engineer provide technical data using FEMA's flood model for certification. Our team hired Barge Solutions to prepare an analysis using FEMA's flood model, and it was reviewed with positive results by Steve Casey at CEC. The total fill area of these four clomars is 127 acres, with 88 acres of excavation. The comparison to Southeast Park is different. It's also shown here on the map. While there are no residential homes proposed in the Southeast Park Master Plan, there are homes around the park. The park grading included floodplain alterations for 66.7 acres. It includes cut and fill in the floodway for a new bridge and 300,000 cubic yards of fill in the floodplain. The flood study shows no increase in flooding upstream or downstream from the park, and the clomar has been approved by FEMA. We believe that Southeast Park will be a great asset to the residents of Franklin, but it has far greater impact to the floodplain and floodway of the Harpeth River than Brownland. And despite the impacts, it is still shown to be a safe and effective way to address floodplain alterations. It passes the test. When talking about altering floodplain, there's no difference in fill if it's done for residential or recreation. Since Envision Franklin was first adopted in 2017, and if you'll look here to the next page, please, four developments have been approved that incorporated floodplain alterations: Splendor Ridge, Reese Farms, Wood Duck Court, and Berry Farms Chadwell. All of these contain conservation policy over the 100-year floodplain areas. The last three, Reese Farm, Wood Duck Court, and Berry Farms Chadwell, required a PUD rezoning and were approved by the board, mayor, and aldermen. Based on an apples-to-apples comparison, Brownland Farms is in line with the percentage of floodplain that's altered. Brownland does not raise the 100-year floodplain. Our master plan improves the floodplain, increases the storage capacity, and removes debris and obstacles that obstruct the flow of water, and restores the floodplain areas to natural habitat and parkland. We believe that we've demonstrated that we can satisfy the conditions of approval required by BOMA in our plans going forward. Our professional engineers have the utmost respect for health, safety, and welfare. Their reputations and licensure depend on it. This is not a gut feeling that determines the end result. This is a professional engineering that FEMA depends on and the city of Franklin depends on. On our last page here is our proposed master plan for Brownlin for your reference. For your consideration tonight is a master plan that reflects my client's willingness to listen and build consensus from you, staff, and the community. This plan has a wide mix of housing, great community open space areas, and improvements to the environment. It is a plan that does not increase flooding upstream or downstream and will increase storage capacity for the floodplain. It is a plan that is better tomorrow than it is today. We believe that this is the right plan and the best plan for Brownlin. And John Michael, just a few minutes.
Mr. Mayor, members of the board. These are not exactly self-imposed conditions, the five conditions that you've heard discussed tonight. I think there's some loss in the semantics here. I don't think that staff has incorrectly stated that we brought those to the board at the strong suggestion, recommendation of various folks that we talked to. So while we did, in fact, my wife sometimes says that I am voluntold to take the children to school rather than her one morning. We were voluntold it would be a good idea to include these five conditions. And to the member of the public's concern, yes, we are still negotiating one of those in particular with regard to the emergency access and the easements associated with that. As I'm sure each of you know, those things don't happen overnight. The work continues. But we have either already completed or agreed to each of the five conditions that bring us back through the channel and to you at the Board of Mayor and Aldermen. The great elements of the project from beginning to end have kind of stayed the same. The plan still provides a vast amount of open space that has public access to much of it. We continue to work with local nonprofits to enhance that open space. The plan even includes 3 miles of greenways built for public use, even a canoe launching point. This plan includes a linear park along the east side of Hillsboro that will benefit Monticello, among others, hopefully. The developer and the Monticello HOA have agreed to traffic control conditions that will be of benefit to the impending increase in traffic that everyone expects. Again, perhaps most importantly, this plan will do no harm with regard to flood safety. The point of your stormwater ordinance, the point of your general plan provisions with regard to stormwater issues is to prevent harm downstream. And the way that our engineers have very capably and professionally designed the project is one that will prevent flooding downstream and also improve conditions upstream. You can trust the engineers for the development, Mr. Gamble and others who have worked on this for many months. You can trust the engineers from the city who have reviewed this. You can trust the third-party engineers that were selected by the city, paid for by the development team, to make sure there was an independent third voice, because all of them agree that this is a solid plan with regard to stormwater management and flood safety management. Does the development meet the general plan? We contend that it does, based upon the fact that Envision Franklin has key provisions with regard to conservation policy areas. This project is one that provides a rich mix of housing types as consistently sought throughout Envision Franklin, not just single family houses. The project carries a density count of 1.53 units per acre, well within what is considered appropriate under Envision Franklin. The project preserves and creates vast amounts of open space. The project protects the form, function, character, and area of the subject area as described in better detail in Mr. Gamble's presentation. Ultimately, the absence of general plan language with regard to residential uses in the conservation policy areas, again, as noted by staff, differentiating there from conservation neighborhood or conservation residential areas, naming that may get reworked later, who knows. Here, in the absence of specific language in the plan, we have to follow the law. And as you may have heard me say before, we followed every letter of the law with regard to this development and the requirements that are put on us. Additionally, when you don't have anything more than law under the policy, it's wise to look to recent precedent. And the examples that Mr. Gamble gave you with regard to Splendor Ridge, Reese Farm, Chadwell, and others is a great way to see what the precedent under the existing conditions of Envision Franklin have been for the city of Franklin in recent years. The law that governs this project does not prohibit alterations of the floodplain. There's a whole lot of very specific language about what you have to do if you're going to alter the floodplain. Our project meets all of those provisions based upon the engineering standards implemented by Mr. Gamble and his team. Even if there was such a desire to outright prevent any construction, any development in a conservation policy area, number one, that's not what the law says, but number two, we can't reverse engineer the effect of law to say, well, but policy talks about this negatively or doesn't really contemplate this, and therefore we're going to treat it the same as law. That sort of law would have to be in the zoning code, part of the Metropolitan Code of Laws, and therefore a legal standard that we would have to meet. The policy is a great document, meaning Envision Franklin. The general plan here is one of the best ones in the state, carefully thought out, massive public input. But it does not have the same effect of law in terms of how we manage the stormwater concerns and flood safety concerns. Ultimately, at the city's direction and various suggestions, the plan has been reworked several times since its conception. But still, the final product accomplishes so much of what the city of Franklin seeks in this project and in all of its residential projects. A great mix of housing stock with moderate density at the most. Great open spaces with ample public access to them. A plan designed to prevent any danger of increased flooding, either upstream or downstream, and a comprehensive sensitivity to the environmental concerns of the Harpeth River. Many of you live along the Harpeth River. I don't live in Williamson County, but I live along the Harpeth River. When things get wet, we all get interested. What I always hope for is a properly engineered plan, whether it be in our subdivisions, near our schools, near the places we shop or worship, that folks have done a good job in making sure that we're maximizing the chances for flood safety for everybody who lives, works, or plays nearby. Having reviewed these plans, as you now will have a chance to do so, I'm confident Mr. Gamble and his team have put forth every conceivable effort, as has the City Engineering Office, as has the third-party independent engineers, in terms of making sure that this poses no danger to other people and can be a great project for the City of Franklin, enjoyed for many years to come. We thank you for your time and consideration this evening, and certainly welcome any questions that you may have. And if they're engineering questions, I will quickly fade into the background.
Okay, thank you. Absolutely, please.
Thank you. I'd just like to say that for a lot of the points that Greg and John Michael made, I believe I'm in agreement with them. I mean, staff has looked at this plan. We've had lots of engineers look at this plan, and technically we've reviewed it against our ordinance and regulations. This really comes down to the request to rezone and the fact that they want to put development in the floodplain, and that we have a document, a long-term policy, that talks about how we should do that. I think if they were trying to develop under their existing zoning, we wouldn't be having this conversation, because we would only be looking at our ordinance and following the rules and regulations. But the thing here is that they're asking to do something more, and we're considering whether that's appropriate or not. So we're looking to our long-range plan and our guiding policies for how we want to develop in the future. And a part of Envision Franklin says we want to conserve areas of the floodplain. So that's why staff is in a stance that we are today. I think the properties that they brought up that were approved recently aren't exactly apples to apples. So many of those were either approved originally prior to Envision Franklin or were not a development plan. So we did not have to look at Envision Franklin for our guidance. We had to, like for Splendor Ridge. Splendor Ridge was a preliminary plat. We don't have the opportunity to look to Envision Franklin at that point. We're simply following the subdivision regulations and the zoning ordinance. Also, the manipulation of the floodplain on that had very little that was originally touching lots. Same thing with Reese Farms. Very little of that floodplain manipulation was to pull it away from where they wanted to put lots. This project is the first one, I believe, that really tests Envision Franklin and its policies on floodplain. So I want everyone to keep that in mind, that this is really the first residential subdivision where we've had to think through this concept. So I'm going to answer any questions about that, but I just wanted to keep that in your mind and make sure that you understand the handout is not necessarily apples to apples.
Go ahead, Alderman Berger.
So with that said, where does FEMA come into this then? Isn't FEMA the ultimate authority on this?
FEMA is the ultimate authority on how you manipulate floodplain.
Right.
Staff stance is, do you want to manipulate the floodplain here?
All right, so let me ask you something else. Even if wherever the Envision Franklin came into play on these subdivisions, I know Fieldstone's been, but Reese Farms has been around for a while, but some of these other ones, fairly new, but were any of these, all of these, I assume would have been rezoned, and...
All of them were rezoned, oh, sorry.
So they've all been rezoned, and... manipulated the floodplains. I mean, it's plain to see, and I think there's some other ones that you left off here, Greg. But So how much flooding do we have in all these areas in these homes? Are these homes being flooded out since they were rezoned and floodplain was manipulated in these areas?
Splendor Ridge hasn't been completely occupied yet or built.
Right.
Reese See, Farms, there hasn't been any houses yeah. developed yet.
Go ahead.
Nor has Wood Duck Court been developed
Did you
yet.
Have something to say? I'm sorry, because
None of these developments have actually started construction. Splendor Ridge is the only one, which is a preliminary plat, as mm-hmm. Amy talked about. The homes are being constructed, and I think
yeah.
being occupied.
Okay. Thanks.
Go ahead, Vice Mayor.
You know, we have been dealing with this for a very long time. That doesn't mean it's not still important. But it's interesting to see all the... You know, I can remember a time when we were wanting to do the small area plan and Brownland was almost to the point of being approved and it paused it. And then we got them out of the small area plan and then it became another situation. So I'm not saying that we owe it to the developer to work within a time frame that helps their project. So I'm not saying that. I'm just saying that I feel like it's become a very contentious development. I think that there's a lot of emotion. I think there's a lot of fear. I think there's a lot of, dare I say, ignorance. I'm not an engineer, but I do feel like, you know, the manipulation of the floodplain, and I don't want to get too far down this path because I don't know what I'm talking about, but with FEMA having the last say, I feel like they're the ones that are taking the responsibility because they draw the floodplain maps. I think that the Anderton family, is moving on to what their farm, if you want to call it that still, Brownland Farm, accommodated the horse industry for a long time in this town. It's not conducive for their fruition of their business. And they are trying to partner with a developer that will do a very sensitive and, I mean, there's been so many different plans. I can't help but support the fact that they continue to dwindle down to make all of us feel comfortable. The fact that Christ Community Church, I won't speak for them, has seemed to be on board all along. Monticello seems to be somewhat, it's just like the longer we wait, the more people are going to give their opinions. And at some point, I feel like we're charged to make a decision. And my decision would be to support it.
Alderman Brown.
Well, I may be on an island here, much like this development, but that's okay. This development has, in my opinion, this is like the poster child for the sentiment, the perception, the frustration of people in Franklin over the development of our city. You've got twice through, planning saying no, staff saying no, Envision Franklin saying no, a zoning request. We've got true risk. I mean, I'm sure there were experts that talked to Fieldstone Farms and Cottonwood and Rebel Meadows and Riser Point. I'm sure they were all thinking that was all good, too. Those houses now are seeking flood insurance. They're now getting water where they never had water before. So, and let's face it, over the last 5 years, our percentage of rain increase has been like 15 inches a year. It's just changing. Things are changing. There is risk on this property. And on top of that, you've got thousands of residents who not only oppose it, are literally fearful that this is going to create issues for them. And I share their concern because I don't think we can absolutely know for sure what will happen in this development and what will happen to this water over time. I just don't think we can. So it seems to me like here we are, we're twice through, planning no, staff no, Envision Franklin no, a zoning request change. We've got risk in here and we've got a resident, we've got neighborhoods surrounding this thing who do not want it. And yet we're entertaining the idea of passing something for a single property owner, which I feel for them. They have every right to sell that property. But I don't think they can walk into the old mall here, pick up a zoning, pick up some modifications, take their cart and go back outside and sell their property for top dollar. I don't think that's our job. I think our job is, what's our vision for Franklin? We talked about this the other day in our planning joint commission. What do we want Franklin to look like? What do we want it to be? This is sitting right in the middle of Ward 2, and I'm telling you, Ward 2 does not want this development as it is. They want to sell this property, great. Keep the zoning as it is. There is something that can be built on that property, for sure. We don't need to change the zoning. We don't need to insert risk. I think we need to we need to have a vision for our town, and we need to be the ones making this decision, and I'm not going to support this thing.
Alderman Baggett.
I think this all boils down to a couple things, well, really one thing, and Amy said it. I mean, it meets everything, and to the zoning point, it's zoned agricultural. It's one house per 15 acres. This is also, Envision Franklin has this conservation subdivision, except for the conservation piece. So there was clearly some idea that this was not going to be one house per 15 acres. So I think the making the zoning that we shouldn't rezone it because this never was going to be one house per 15 acres. And our plan says that. Okay, so I think that, I understand, but that doesn't do much for me. The thing that is the problem for me is this is, Matt, this is an island. And there's no way not to touch conservation to do something here. I mean, they're really, it literally, if you look at Envision Franklin, the cow or the horse dung mound is in conservation subdivision, so you can do 50% development on that cow dung or the horse dung raised piece. So it goes to show that our plan isn't perfect. We took the contours of the floodplain, and that's how we determined what conservation was. So if we didn't pull out the horse dung pile out of and put that in conservation, we left it in conservation subdivision, knowing there's not going to be 50% development. I mean, so there is room for interpretation, in my opinion, of this plan, of the Envision Franklin plan. But the thing that is, there's some standard, and these were approved. There's some standard in between doing absolutely nothing in conservation and doing something in conservation. Because clearly we have it has been approved and recommended by staff to do something in conservation other than recreational use. So there is some standard in between what is written down and what we've actually done. And for some reason, this doesn't meet that. And that's where I'm hung up on is, what is this, what is the standard in between what we have had approved and staff has recommended and Planning Commission has recommended on all these, Planning Commission recommended these other projects. So there's this standard that we don't have written down where we say it's okay to do something in conservation other than recreational use, and I don't know what that is. And so that's problematic for me because then I have to just look at this, and when you say I can't recommend it because it doesn't meet conservation, but neither did the other ones. And so there's something in between where someone just gets a good feeling, I guess, about it, that this meets the, if it was a little bit lower, a little bit high, like, I don't know what it is. And so that's where I'm hung up on. But it bends me towards, you know, favoring the applicant because we haven't set a standard, and we've clearly said things one way. We've said things are okay in some situations and not another. The other thing I wanted to say was there's no multifamily in this. I wouldn't have voted for the last plan. It didn't meet Envision Franklin, all conservation subdivision to start with. That's problem. That, you know, and they changed it. This is not a place for multifamily. We have a overload of multifamily in this town. Last thing, it's just that's where I'm hung up on, and I want it to be clear, and it's not. And this needs to be noted that in future, and because it's the applicant has knew that we did this. We did this before Envision Franklin. It was okay to do this in Ladd Park. I mean, it happened in Ladd Park. And then we kept doing it, and now it's like, oh, stop. You know, we can't do anymore. So that's another thing. Flood safety is paramount to me, and I'm done after this. But I'm okay with the flood safety, and here's why. Because the city of Franklin relied on engineering studies. We manipulated the Southeast Park five times as much as going to be manipulated here and didn't put back 50%. And I don't think that was an error. I think that's the engineering supports it. I live in the floodplain downstream from Southeast Park, and I didn't hear all the people upset about Southeast Park when we were moving 500,000 cubic yards of dirt to fill in the floodplain in Southeast Park. So I'm still hung up on the conservation, but I think we have to at some point, you know, rely on the engineers. Thank you.
Go ahead, Alderman Hanson.
All right. First, I want to address the traffic. And I'm sure there's not a lot of you in this room who have been to any of the no-frills Brownland horse shows over the years, but I have. And if you take thousands of young girls in hundreds and hundreds of cars and quad horse trailers going very slowly, packing in there, and still no traffic congestion, I'm not seeing how this is going to be an out-of-control traffic situation. And that went on a really regular basis, and it was very well controlled, and there was nobody directing any traffic. People drove in, people drove out, quad trailers, no problem. So I don't think we're going to have the traffic problem that people are afraid of. I think a lot of this is the fear of the unknown. It's the what if, because we all lived through the 2010 floods, so we're terrified this is going to happen again. May or may not, but you may be hit by a car tonight and you may die too. So I don't think we should just operate out of fear of the unknown. On Envision Franklin, that is like the holy grail of Franklin, and it's a very flawed document. Grappling with office residential with a preferred and recommended use from the city to take your office space and have a chicken farm or a garden, kid you not, under office residential. Having another issue right now in one of those conservation districts that I emailed about last week, things that just don't add up, things that don't make sense, that it's so constraining that sometimes it's outside common sense. And I love what it does, and I love the format of preserving Franklin and keeping uniformity, but I do think it's a very flawed document, and I don't think we should rely solely on Envision Franklin for our ideas. And I do know that we do have precedent for this type of development, and I also contend that this family deserves to be able to sell their property, and at some point it's not going to be saleable anymore, and people are going to throw up their hands, and that's not right either. So it is a sticky situation. It's very hard. It's almost like there's not a right or a wrong decision, but I do think that there's precedent for this type of development to go forward.
I'm sorry. Go ahead, Alderman Potts.
Mr. Mayor, I did have a couple of things to say, but I know that I saw the applicants writing down a couple of things. I don't know if this might be also.
Now, this is your time to speak.
This is just ours.
They had their time to speak.
Perfect.
I was very liberal in giving them much more time than they asked for. So
perfect.
It's your turn.
Excellent. So the questions that I have on this is, as Alderman Baggett was also mentioning this, and we were all taking a look, and we'll have to pardon the microphones picking up all these papers, is the apples to apples comparison. And I do like seeing apples to apples. As I look at this, and what we're talking about over in Ladd Park and right there at Water's Edge, that's in my ward, and I'm very focused on that area and the amount of soil that was moved and what we anticipate hopefully won't ever have to deal with regarding the flooding. From what I understand right now, it appears to be working, but there are some areas of concern that are there along that bend near between Water's Edge and Southeast Park. And part of the concern that I have is, as we make these changes, and again, I rely on the experts, but if we were to move forward and to make these changes, part of my concern is ensuring that the proper backfill, the proper dirt as well as the proper gravel, the proper stone, the proper size of stone. I've received indirect information saying that maybe the right size stone may not have been used previously on some other sites over there near Water's Edge. And I want to make sure, because I think, Alderman Hanson is right. This area does need to be developed. And I think that it's time for it to be developed. And I think that the owner has that right. And it's
We're at the point right now where I have to lean on what the experts are saying. And Envision Franklin is a guide. It is a great guide. And as someone along our board just said, it's one of the best in the state. And I look at it right now, and if every checkbox is met by FEMA or by our by the engineers that's required, then I see the development moving forward. But I say that with a little bit of caution. So I'll continue to do more research.
Alderman Peterson.
Thank you. I do want to say that sometimes what has been shown by engineers, for example, whenever Fieldstone Farm was approved, there was not a single lot there that showed up in the floodplain by FEMA. Now, how many hundreds of lots there are now in the floodplain? So just to say that because someone states at a certain time that something is the case, because I can tell you, and I don't want to go back too far, the reason that I became interested in anything about planning and development was because I was in a house that was flooded and I walked with my 2-year-old in my arms. And the other thing that I have been so concerned about is that where the Harpeth River does make all the curves that we're talking about here, once it gets to a certain place, it goes over the banks and everything there, because the Harpeth, as it comes through Franklin, the elevation of it decreases as you go along. In other words, if you look at what the height is, then as it moves through Franklin, it goes down several feet. I mean, in terms of what is in the floodplain there. That may be too number crazy for people. But whenever we talked about, a concern that I have had is that at a certain place, it may cross over and not stay in the banks there. And I do appreciate the illustration of the floodplain that has been changed slightly in the Water's Edge area. Please stop and think. There has not been a big flood event in Franklin since that was built. And the 2010 flood even itself was not a 100-year flood. It was the 50-year flood, and I heard that directly from a FEMA engineer. But my concern is that this piece of property is different in many respects. And as I say, it's not just curvy there. It's basically encircled by parts of the river itself. And I didn't even like it whenever I found out that whenever we approved the stormwater ordinance that it meant we could do cut and fill, because in all the years before then, the city of Franklin had declined cut and fill. They did not have it in their rules or anything. And then I found out that after the flood, the stormwater ordinance passed, it allowed cut and fill. But to say that this would be a safe neighborhood is something that I have a great concern about. And of all the places, including these things that they showed where something, has changed and everything, they are different in many respects, even though I personally did not like seeing changes in the floodplain. And the other thing is that the FEMA had some proposals to change the floodplain in the city of Franklin, and they've had it out for some months here. And as I understand, in Nashville, they have made the official changes to the flood map, but they have said that they're not going to do that yet for a year in Franklin, is what I understand. And so I haven't personally looked back to see what that would affect here. But I still go back to Fieldstone and those other places, and I guarantee you there was not a single lot at the time that that was approved that had any land in the floodplain, and now many of them do. And not only that, they flooded in 2010. It wasn't just there in the floodplain, they flooded then. And I would not like to see us give that opportunity to occur again. And as I say, to me, this property is probably as big a concern as I've seen on any that I've seen proposed to us.
Thank you, Alderman Peterson. Alderman Garnhill.
Just a couple of comments. We should not use Envision Franklin to look at a project negatively. It should be something that we should be using Envision Franklin to look positively to. Okay? That's enough at that. The second comment is this. I have not heard any word, anybody say that they can positively identify this project right here as negatively affecting anything downstream. If this is here and there's 10 inches of rain in a certain area, in a certain time, there's going to be just as much flooding as if the project is not there. Is that a fair statement?
Because, again, like I said, there's rules of FEMA that we would have to abide by.
So that's a fair statement. So to come back and use the flooding of 2010 and the flooding of 2022 and whatever else we've had, to use that, that's not accurate. That's just not accurate to use those numbers. There would be no more flooding in Fieldstone in 2010 if that's there or if it's not there. Okay, well, disagree and show me. Show me the engineering report. Show me whatever professional, our engineering staff, the engineers that we asked to be hired, show where that's been anywhere documented that this project negatively affects with what they've done on the project and the corrections and the additions that they've made negatively affect any downstream or upstream. Okay, well, you know, and we sit here and say we look at Envision Franklin, and it has never been a document that's ever been approved or accepted by BOMA. It is a planning document, and it is supposedly a good document. I've heard that comment tonight. It's the best in Tennessee. It may be the only one in Tennessee.
No. Many places have land use
You're
plans,
that way.
And this is a land use plan.
And Envision in Franklin, they don't have Envision Franklin. They might have Envision something. And the other thing is this, and just you know, times change. I know Ann has made reference to Fieldstone and it being out of the floodplain, in the floodplain, lots here, lots there, whatever. In 1988, there was a drought. We had a water shortage. We were rationing water. Again, in 1989 and 1991 and 1992, those years, if you go back and look, I can guarantee you that's what was happening because that's the reason I ran. I mean, 1987, we had a drought. 1988, I thought, well, you know, somebody should be able to do better than this. We shouldn't have water rationing. And we bless our hearts.
Hadn't had it since.
And hadn't had it since. And the only thing that negatively come out of that stayed is we did away with fireworks shooting on the 4th of July in Franklin. I mean, we can shoot them all the way around. But legally, we can't shoot them in Franklin. But I'll support this. I think they've done a yeoman's job in trying to do everything they could possibly do to make this project acceptable and not a negative impact on any resident downstream or upstream.
I want to say one further thing about this access. I think that, I mean, I don't know how that could make a lot of things a lot better, but if it's not there, then I think that really is a definite step back.
Well, I think you have to have that.
I'm going to give Alderman Berger just a quick comment, and then Mr. Stuckey had asked if he could make a comment. And so go ahead, Alderman Berger. We've got a lot to go.
Yeah, I had not even given my comments because I just did ask that one question. Sorry, that was my question. But, you know, I talked to CDC and I talked to Barge. I purposely called them to ask them questions. I talked to our engineering department. Because to me, the bottom line has to be do no harm. Has to be. I'm sorry?
Are you on?
Yes, I am.
Okay.
It just has to be do no harm. And why is that? I think that we look at things that were built a long time ago, and we've had issues. I wasn't as fortunate as Alderman Peterson. I got stuck in my house during a flood, and it was pretty bad. It was real bad.
I was stuck in the two-story house next door to me when we walked across.
And so I was there for a long time, and I watched my cars float away. Two cars out front. I watched all my patio furniture. I watched everything float away but us and the kids. And I was home alone with two kids. And, you know, so... been in a flood, I've been in a hurricane, I've been in all sorts of things, earthquakes, pretty bad ones, real bad ones. Been there, done that. Don't want to do the fire, though. But I think that we have to ask ourselves, we now have more modern surveying. We certainly have more modern surveying, and our abilities haven't changed. We now have more unlimited cross-sections than we used to, because I think they were like every 1,000 feet or 2,000 feet before, and now we have them, they're unlimited. And we also have the ability to model the river in 3D models. So to me, those things make a huge difference today when we're planning, and why people can engineer companies, two, three of them, our engineer team can all say, do no harm. There is no impact upstream, downstream. So at some point, I'm with some of these other aldermen. We've got to trust the experts on these. We've got to move ahead. We can beat this over the head over and over and over, but we have to come to some conclusion that we have to trust the experts on this, and we have to get to a point where we feel comfortable enough that we will do no harm. In the aspects that are really important here, which is water, and which is safety and access. So those are my points. And I agreed with a lot of things that were said here tonight, and I won't repeat them.
Okay. We're ready to move on?
Well, can I make a quick comment?
Oh, I'm sorry. I know you asked me.
You teed me up, and then, you know.
I teed you up. I just wanted you to fall off the tree like it does sometimes.
I'll just make this really quick. I think what we're talking about here is you do have a policy that says you don't allow certain development in conservation. That's your policy. In certain cases, you've allowed for exceptions. Where this is different is a significant number of lots rely on that. In these others, that was not the case. There may be a few or whatever or other areas within the development. I think that's a significant difference. And that's the policy question. I think you're primarily being asked that you have not been asked before, especially this board has not been asked. So you don't have to decide tonight. You're going to hear from the public in 6 weeks. You're going to have other time to think this through. I guess my question for you to think about, and you don't need to answer it now, is there something else you need from staff to support you in thinking through that decision? Staff's job is to assist you. The applicant's persuading you. That's their job. But our job is to assist you. The public's going to try to persuade you, different views, but we're here to assist you. So let us know how we can help you with that. This isn't easy. and it is different. And that's why it's, and I don't want you to get in the false box of, well, you did it in this one time, so you should do it here.
No.
It's not the same. And you're getting to decide when you do rezoning, especially, you are making a policy decision. So you get to do that. Don't feel like you're in a box, and let us help you in whatever way we can.
Mm-hmm. Go ahead, Alderman Just Brown. It's your
order. The one thing I would like to request, we keep saying that ultimately FEMA is going to make a decision, and so I think some of this is like, oh, well, we'll let FEMA say yes or no. But there is a document, I'm pretty sure, that city staff has to sign off on to go to FEMA that actually attest that there is no risk, there's no concern. I forget the language, but it's a paragraph that they sign off on. Yeah.
The document, not a Palmer?
So whatever, whatever we send to get FEMA to look at this, there is a document that city staff signs. So it does, ultimately, there is ownership and accountability by city staff to sign that document. Yeah. I think we all need to be aware of that document, understand what that language is. I did not bring a copy of it with me, but I do believe that exists. I think we should look at that because at the same time, we keep saying it's going to be on FEMA, but the reality is it's going to be on us first.
Okay, item 10 is resolution 2022-03, a resolution initiating the annexation process and draft plan of services for 17.25 acres located east of Lewisburg Pike and south of Goose Creek Bypass. Joey?
Thank you. This parcel is within the urban growth boundary and it is contiguous to the city limits. It was classified as a high growth area based on our 2016 growth study. It is within the single-family residential design concept in Envision Franklin, and that is the property owner's intended use for the future of the property. There is a draft plan of services attached as an exhibit that outlines how the city will serve the property requesting annexation. Recent infrastructure has been upgraded in this area due to previous annexations and development. The property owner will need to work with our water management department about sewer extension, but staff recommends approval of the initiation. Happy to answer any questions.
Item 11, resolution 2022-09, a resolution initiating the annexation process, draft plan of services for 2.07 acres located at 517 Franklin Road, establishing a public hearing. Joe, you got them all, didn't you?
Not all, thankfully. So this was actually identified as a low priority growth area in the 2016 study. Based on just several factors. The subject property is within a large lot residential design concept in Envision Franklin. It is the intention of the applicant to continue to use the property as residential and subdivide into a total of two lots. Each lot would be approximately 1 acre in size, which is consistent with the large lot residential design concept of Envision Franklin. There is a draft of services included as an attachment. Although the property was identified as a low priority growth in that study, staff has found no issues in the ability to serve the property for the intended use of residential. So with that in mind, staff is also recommending approval for this initiation as well.
Go ahead, Alderman Berger.
That's almost right. It's not right next door to Clearview. It's right past the subdivision. So is sewer right there? Because we did put sewer in subdivision that used to be on my ward. It's now in yours.
I believe Highgate. So. It's
Highgate, yeah.
Yeah, Highgate.
It is.
Yeah, there's this, the,
and sewer, the. So we put sewer in there. So is that going to be able to connect right there?
Yes.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. I should be able to. Yeah. But it's broken down in the plan of services under the storm.
Yeah, because I know where we ran that. Yes. And then whose water is that? Do you know? Whose water authority? That's not our water authority, is it? Is that?
I think it's Mallory.
Mallory? I was just curious. That's all right.
It'll be in the draft.
Yeah,
the
don't
services.
Worry. That's not a big deal.
It's
more.
It's Mallory Valley.
Mallory Valley. Yeah. I thought maybe it would be. But I just wanted to know more about the sewer. That's easily to hook up. So they'll be doing that.
Yes.
So. Okay, good. Thanks.
Okay, item 12 is amendment number 3 to City of Franklin contract 2020-0012 with Hazen and Sawyer for evaluation of Franklin South Eastern Wastewater Capacity Clean Water Facility Site Investigation. You're looking to see how many sinkholes you got.
So the initial geotech that was done with the engineering group showed some sinkholes, and because of the park maintenance building, we are looking at doing some borings to understand the geology of that, and if we're going to need to move our structures and the ability of us to move our structures.
Good explanation. Item 13 is resolution 2022-18, resolution to increase the hourly rate for extra duty police officers and authorize the chief of police to allow the use of patrol cars for extra duty work.
So chief is coming up to speak to this as well, but we set a rate for special detail work. So it's privately contracted work that our police officers do for security. You see it at churches, businesses, special events. And we last adjusted this rate 3 years ago, and we have used just sort of a single rate. And what we have seen is an increase in demand for those types of services, as well as more difficulty in getting them scheduled with our officers. So we've took a second look, and Chief and her team looked at it and recommended that we adjust the rates, but also look at changing the structure of the rates, like differentiating a little bit within the extra duty types of services. So currently it's $45 per hour for an officer, $55 for a supervisor, and then there's a $5 per hour charge related to the use of a patrol car and $5 for our workers' compensation coverage. So what is being suggested is that we create a category that is scheduled or reoccurring uses. So what you see at a church or certain businesses where we're there on a regular basis, it's scheduled ahead of time. We kind of count on it, know it's happening. And that would move to a $50 per officer per hour, $60 per officer per hour for supervisors, and then blend together that vehicle slash workers' compensation component into a $10 rate, which is essentially the office, the administrative overhead cost associated with it. So that would be the scheduled reoccurring for special events, non-holiday special events. It would be a $60 per officer, $70 per supervisor, and then of course the $10 as well. And then for special events or detail work on a designated city holiday, it would be 75 and 85 respective for officer and supervisor, again, with all of those, the $10 per hour applying. We think this gets us at a better position to make it more attractive to officers, you know, make that time for pay trade-off more an easier call for them to make so that we can staff them. It does differentiate these. It's harder to get people to take a holiday and do this work. And so we want to recognize that, and we think this will put us in a better position. And by making it more attractive, it takes a burden off, because sometimes chiefs having to shift patrol folks around to just make sure everybody's safe and it's happening okay. So, Chief, I don't know if
it
you want to
add more and more special events in our city, more and more people attending those, and we have to do it for public safety. So, not looking at this for about a little over 3 years, I think this is a better market value for what they do and the risk. I appreciate your consideration.
And we would put this in effect starting July 1. So this would be something we would feed into our special event process as applicants come forward, and then provides an updated rate for the folks we have an ongoing relationship with.
Thank you, Chief. Item 14 is City of Franklin Contract 2021-190196 with the Tennessee Department of Environmental Conservation, TDEC, for the Volkswagen Medium and Large Truck Grants Program.
First, I'd like to say good evening to everyone, and thank you for letting me take this opportunity to present this information to you. I want to tell you a little bit of how we got here. It's been like kind of a two-year process with this grant. In 2015, Volkswagen admitted to deliberately putting faulty equipment in their emissions in their vehicles. So thus, we end up here with the medium truck, and grant was established. So the City of Franklin has had the opportunity to apply for the grant, and we were awarded a grant in the amount of over $417,000. With this grant, we plan to take the money and to purchase a fully electric truck to haul our recycling and our wood chips. With this, if the city chooses to accept this grant, we have 2 years to execute this grant and meet the stipulations of the grant and have the equipment by March 31st, 2024. So in this grant, the full cost of the truck is over $426,000. Again, we will be getting $417,000 in grant money. And then we're also looking for, looking to have the charging stations will come up to at least $34,000 for a charging station. At least one charging station at SES facilities, and then we're looking to have another charging station at the fleet facilities for that purpose. Yes, sir.
So Nate, he's the assistant director of Sanitation Environmental Services. I'm not sure if everyone here has met him yet. Nate had ferried this process through the whole grant program and successfully won this grant. So we're really excited to have this opportunity. The question is, do we want to get into this business? We're advocating for a road tractor to carry our tractor trailers for, as Nate mentioned, wood chips and also recyclables down to our recycling processor. So I just wanted to take the opportunity and introduce Nate because he doesn't get up here often. But so anyway, go ahead, Nate. Sorry to interrupt.
That's fine. We're also looking, part of the grant, part of the stipulations, we would take one of our underutilized rear loaders and scrap the vehicle. So we're losing the value of the sale of that vehicle. We're estimating at least $50,000 for the sale of that vehicle. The expense to the department is approximately, you're looking at over $47,000 that would be out of pocket estimated. And that's including the lost revenue that comes to a total of, you're looking at over $93,000. Traditionally for a traditional diesel or a road tractor, you're looking at a cost of $160,000. Just if we buy it straight out, just a regular diesel vehicle. Some of the stuff that we're going to be looking at in this vehicle, if we're able to purchase this vehicle, is no noise pollution, zero emissions for greenhouse gases, no fuel costs. We're looking to cut the fuel costs if we're able to do it, and savings up to 80% on the total energy costs because we're going to be charging the vehicle in the evening time. So you're going to look at the grid being a little bit lower cost on the grid. Oil-free operations, no oil changes, no oil leaks, no mechanical failures of that nature. And then we're also looking at longer-lasting brakes due to the regenerative brake system also. And these trucks, we will also use, we're looking at a DC fast charger, probably up to at least 180 kilowatts for the charging stations. And then staff recommends that you consider accepting this grant and signing this grant. Yes, ma'am.
Go ahead, Alderman.
Will these charging stations charge other type of vehicles or just that one specific vehicle?
It will be...
So if we added more in the fleet later, could it be
yes,
used
ma'am.
On that too?
Yes, ma'am. It could charge other vehicles.
It kind this, of... Yeah, go ahead. Good.
Is this is the grant... The requirement of the grant, I assume, is to buy an electric or no emissions...
Yeah. Full electric.
Fully electric. Yes, sir.
We did look at side loaders and some other options. This seemed to be the straightest, most straightforward route. They're very limited in that and in some of the types of vehicles. And really, the grant's sort of a free shot at trying an electric vehicle on this scale, this type of vehicle. So I think that's why Nate and the team pursued it and why we're recommending it and believe it makes sense for us.
Alderman Berger, do you want to make a comment?
I like always to have a sheet that goes pros, cons, savings, cost, you know, whatever. So I can compare them. So how long, first of all, does a truck hold the charge?
You're looking at it depends on the conditions of the battery, conditions of the charge. And it's kind of funny that you asked that question because I kind of wrote it down. It says natural charging speed depends on the electric vehicle model.
Mm-hmm.
And then it also depends on the charging conditions of the battery, weather, mm-hmm. whether it's hot, whether it's cold, whether it's raining. So you're going to run into different variables once you get into the charging station.
Do we Is it going to be six hours? Is it going to be 2 hours?
You're looking for the whole average charge, and we based it off of going from here to Lewisburg, at least holding a charge from 6 to 8 hours, with the 8-hour workday.
Okay, so typical, you could do 6 to 8 hours, go to Lewisburg, come back, and you'd be fine.
We expect to be able to operate the vehicle for the duration of any working day, recharge overnight, and then pick back up.
Okay, got that.
Yes,
and ma'am. Then, so what's the typical mileage that we would go there and back?
Typical mile.
And we'd go one time?
We would go twice. So we got it in the range of 230 mile range.
That's round trip, two trips.
Yes,
okay.
Ma'am.
And then fuel cost, what's the savings, long-term fuel cost? How long does it take to charge? We talked about that, I think. But the fuel cost, what's the typical savings there? Sort of like to look at that.
So
long-term, I'd look at that, and I'd say, okay, I'd look at all these numbers, and I'd say, well, a lot of times we spend money in sustainability issues. We spend money up front that really doesn't pan out at the end to give us the cost savings we'd want. Other times we say, okay, here's the upfront cost, but in the long term, long haul, it's going to save us a boatload of money down the road.
Right.
So
we anticipate, I think Nate had mentioned it, it's an estimated 80% energy savings. So that, that's the cost of the electricity for the truck, and it also accounts for the fuel. So energy, it captures the fuel costs as well as the electric costs in that as well. We've not done a long-term analysis on it. Part of this program is that we're going to monitor for the first 5 years, I think, is part of the grant as well, monitor performance, monitor cost savings relative to a diesel vehicle, all of those things. So that's going to happen as a matter of course through this.
Remind me again, what's our upfront cost through all this?
The cost of the truck is about $9,000 more than the grant total. But we're also looking at about $40,000 for charging stations as well.
How much?
Again,
40.
40. So 40. I think it's 37 and change, if I remember.
Yes.
So,
37. Okay.
And those chargers are going to be available. We want to do one at fleet maintenance, so it'll be available for not only an SES vehicle, but any other electric fuel vehicles we look at in the future, and as well as one at sanitation for not only this vehicle, but potential vehicles in the future. And that's a whole other issue that we're evaluating right now. We've been doing a bit of research and trying to understand the best approach to move towards electric. It's a big deal. And you got to do a lot of planning for it and what you think is the best bang for the buck, et cetera. So we've been in the process of doing that over the last 12 months or so and trying to better understand it. So
with all your research, bottom line, do you think this, if we jumped in to do this, this would be a good test market for us long-term to really learn from this and see if we would go forward in the future with other vehicles?
I think so.
Is this cost-effective to do this?
Well, you start with all the net costs. You start $76,000 to the positive just starting it.
Mm-hmm.
And then you've got the benefit of the fuel savings and the maintenance savings over time. And kind of like I said before, it's sort of a funded pilot program for us to look at a large vehicle and see how that works. Mm-hmm. And so I think and there's the grant requires us to, but we would anyway track these costs and understand what it might mean if we rolled it out into another truck, or if a viable side loader option comes up, what would that look like for us? Mm-hmm. It just helps us better understand it, because there's more information in the consumer vehicle world, but not so much in these large trucks. So it's a chance for us to learn something, and maybe other cities as well.
Yeah, well, we have to.
The EPA just came out with a ruling by 2034. I may be wrong on the date, that they have to reduce the emissions by like 90% on diesel vehicles.
Yeah, it's 2034, I think, too. I saw that. So long term. Okay. I think I've got my questions answered. I just, I think this would be probably a good thing to do. Yeah.
All right. We need to move on. Yeah, go ahead.
If you bought a compatible vehicle, diesel, how much is it?
You're looking at at least $160,000 for just a regular diesel vehicle.
So the gas, the electric is
plus the gas.
Over 2 times.
Yeah, but our grant's covering all that. Well, that's it eliminates that issue.
Yeah. Okay, items.
We're looking at for the grant. It will be about April for when the grant starts.
And then we have 2 years.
Okay. Yes, ma'am.
Now we're going to look at items 15, 16, 17, 18 together. These are basically authorizations, the use of competitive sealed bids on group health prescription drug and vision benefits, group dental benefits, supplemental life, accident, death, and dismemberment, and long-term disability, and employee assistance program.
Yeah. I use the term competitive proposals, not bids, but yes.
Competitive sealed proposal.
This is anything different.
This is all our benefits, insurance packages, and it's due to be go out to market again.
But we've been doing this all along. Yes. I mean, we're not changing this.
But we have the board authorize us to go get competitive proposals.
I just ask that in the EAP program, I think y'all are probably looking at it, but for the counseling benefit,
yes,
looking at that more specifically for all employees.
Yeah.
We're
looking
PTSD,
to enhance it for first responders, public safety in particular, that there's some more tailored services there.
And then items 19 and 20 are contracts with attorneys for additional real estate, voluntary purchase, and eminent domain.
Title search work.
How's that?
Good evening, everyone. I'm Bill Squires. We may or may not have met. I'm the assistant city attorney. I know about half of you are looking at me like, did you really just tell us your name again? These are two contracts. The law department keeps an on-call sort of rotating list of title opinion providers. We try to expand that as much as we can. The first one that you see there with Mr. Thomas Hutto from Dale Hutto and Lyle, we ran an RFQ back in last fall in November to try and get some more attorneys to help get on that on-call list. Mr. Hutto's firm responded and was responsive. We're recommending approving him to join the on-call list so that he will go into rotation and get some of that business. The second contract you see there, number 0026, is actually a current attorney, Mr. Mark Dougal, does good work for us. He's merged his firm with another firm. I always get their name wrong, Foreman, Watson, and Holtry. Still does the same work, still the same attorney. But we need to reduce some of the documents because it's technically with a different firm now. I'm happy to answer any questions you might have.
Okay, we'll go to item 21 then. Thank you, Bill. The draft scope of schedule and fee for the schematic design phase two for the new city hall.
Vernon's coming up to speak to it specifically, but this is essentially what we talked to you about 2 weeks ago. It adds on a market study component to help us look at retail options and what that might mean for us both operationally and from a revenue generation standpoint. Also helps us do the programming update that would reflect the phased approach that we've talked about that fits within our financial capacity. And then from that point, we would come back to the board, get feedback and guidance before we go into the actual schematic design work. That's included in the scope, but there is a checkpoint with you after we've done that initial work of market study and the programming update to reflect the just under 80,000 square foot option for phase one.
Vern? Oh, thank you, Eric. Good evening, Alderman. Just to add on, our consultant has interviewed and received proposals from several market analyst consultants, and this proposal includes them engaging the services of Bob Gibbs and his planning group. Some of you may remember back in early 2000s, Mr. Gibbs came here and spoke when we had the Seaside Institute discussion. I wasn't here at that time, but I heard it was very impressive. I had the opportunity to hear Mr. Gibbs speak. He instructs at Harvard a class, and he specializes in analyzing historic and retail districts, and this proposal, as in the scope of services, inclusive of office, retail, and a financial analysis. And we look, as Eric mentioned, want to bring that back to you as soon as it's completed. Probably about 70 to 80 days or so is the expected time frame. During that time, we do want you to approve the professional services agreement that we'll either bring to you in 2 weeks or 4 weeks as we finalize it. That'll include the scope and services that was in your packet. So our consultant can work with our team to update the programming document. That'll help us look at a smaller area than what was originally proposed, because either the PSA will be for the 78.5 square foot footprint with the full parking structure. But if we make a decision to go with the full master plan and leasable space, understandably, there's still going to be a reduced area than what was originally planned in that programming document. It'll also allow us, if the decision is made after you've looked at the economic analysis and the market study and looked at the pro forma that's related to that, to simply allow us to amend the PSA that we're looking for you to approve here in a couple weeks while we continue to work. So there won't be a stop, and that will save us several weeks, if not a few months, if we can keep that moving forward from a project management standpoint. We're happy to answer any questions. Kelly and Joe are here that work very closely with Eric, myself, and Michael, and several other team members to keep the eye on the target.
Alderman Brown.
So maybe just a clarification. I thought we were all leaning towards larger and retail, but we had some critical questions around what that debt would look like different than city property and all that. There were some financial decisions in there that then would allow us probably to make a pretty clear decision here about which direction to go. So I'm just trying to understand where that's going to hit, because it almost sounds like we're going to be looking at this saying, yes, go on this. We're going to start playing on the 78,000, and then we might make an adjustment later. Wouldn't we want to just make that decision now?
No, if I may.
Okay. Please. So
as we're talking about, the main direction you gave us was the economic consultation, the market analysis. And that'll take about 2 to 3 months to complete, to bring back to you. We still are only upon approval of the PSA that we want done in a couple weeks or so, we only want the consultant to work on updating the programming document. Very little, if any, work on the schematic design. That'll allow us to work with our team to see how we'll work in a smaller footprint, whatever it is, the 78,000 or the 115 less the leasable space. And that's why we want to keep moving forward. And if the decision is for the bigger footprint, all we'll need to do is amend the PSA for a larger building. And that'll be more consulting fees than the 1.4. And we won't have to stop to do that.
But we have to approve the whole thing to get to, I understand what you're saying. But the reprogramming could also impact the size. This is just saying by default we're at least doing the 78,000.
You've got to understand that option.
This is saying we're going to we're approving that. I don't know if that's I was hoping this market analysis and the programming redesign would give me more confidence in the 78 even. So it was a combination of not just going bigger, but then more confidence in the reprogramming, because I think that was we saw the boxes, mm-hmm. or we saw the highlighted areas, but the reprogramming would also help me feel better about the 78. So I'm a little hesitant to do the 78 or just do the 1.4 million If that makes sense. I don't know if we can break it out or if that complicates things.
It does, yeah. And it would add delay and time, which we can do. But we are committed to the economic consultation and only commencing work on updating the programming document. That's going to take longer, if you look at the scope, than we'll be back to you with the consultant's study. And we intend to bring him here because this is a really important decision for our community. And also, I do want to mention this. In approving the PSA and the scope for the schematic design, we'll be coming back to you four times specifically, simultaneously when we approach the DRC, that's the Design Review Committee of the Historic Zoning Commission, at 25, 50, 75%. So when we get to the end, we're all aligned. And that's really important too. So hopefully I've explained that well enough that gives you the confidence when we bring the PSA, it'll include this scope and services that we can get on with it.
To specifically address what I think you were getting at, we've got to understand that phased approach, what that 78,500 square foot, how that would really function. Because quite frankly, that's what you can afford right now. Then the economic market study will help us understand what does that add to our capacity? How does it fit with what a city hall would be like, that it's consistent with that? What is it? How does it look and feel maybe on Third Avenue in particular? So I think those are all things that will help us have a better understanding, and then you can give us guidance on what that building is that we want to design as we really go into schematic design at that kind of checkpoint.
But once we sign the PSA, we're in for the 1.4.
No, you could terminate at the end of that point. You can end your contract anytime you want.
At the end of the schematic.
If you decide you want to pull the plug, you can pull the plug.
Alderman Hanson, did you want to?
No, that
answer. Gotcha. You want to go on to 20? Go ahead. You're on.
Yeah, I'm now on after you get it punched.
You're getting better at it, Clyde.
Well, when you reach around to get to it, you have to be careful what you reach around. Do we want to be in the landlord business?
I think that's what the market analysis might help you understand.
Clyde, it's not,
that's part of why we're doing
landlord.
This.
It would be a master lease, and all we do is collect money, and somebody else becomes the landlord.
Okay. Somebody else becomes
but ultimately
landlord.
You do own the property,
but
so you have to understand
ultimately
that means.
We own the property.
Yep.
All right.
I can assure you, and sorry for interrupting, but I just want to be clear because we represent the city colleagues, and you know we'd be very excited to be able to develop this whole site, but we know that we're going to be fiscally responsible. We are very confident that Mr. Gibbs and his team will give you the information you need to make a decision in about 3 months.
And I'm not, I think I've had comments on from citizens at a town hall where they were very open to small levels of retail on Third Avenue on the first floor. So even if we do the 78 and having some sort of retail component is still, I think we should be open-minded to it to activate the street. We don't need to be in the landlord business, but necessarily in that full, and you made a good point, but I think we can't just think of it as it's the way to fund the whole thing. There can also be smaller components that go into this option one or three or one or whatever it was, the 78-3.
Well,
you want to say something, Alderman Peterson?
I don't know whether this is the place to say it or as we're talking about the next one, but I want to make sure that everyone understands that we also need to look very, very, very carefully at what this thing looks like because it is on the square here. And whenever I looked back at some other things that we were talking about kind of comparing it to, I have found that they don't look like the square. And one of the things that I'm so concerned about is, and also even in our, you know, whenever we do the flipping book and everything on it and all the other things, it shows all these things with this huge expanse of glass or something glass-like. I mean, you just see so many things that they have pictures of where you're looking at one entire wall being glass. And there's so many things like that that I want to make sure that we are thinking, I mean, of course, the outer appearance doesn't mean everything, but it does mean a lot here.
Well, that's going to be critically important, and that's a big part of what schematic design will help you understand. You'll start to get into architecture. At this stage, that's not what we looked at. Mm-hmm. We looked at master plan in terms of scale and how we locate departments and those interactions and the public flow and that kind of stuff. But you'll see that. And our historic zoning guidelines wouldn't allow us to build a glass Cool Springs-like office building here in downtown. And we wouldn't propose that to you. I mean, I think the comparison I would give you is what happened next door with the old First Tennessee building that's now called the 231 Public Square building. Similar situation, similar era, not a lot of windows. We know we need more windows, but you can do it in a way that looks and fits downtown and the architecture and the character of downtown. And that's going to be foremost in our minds as we look at exterior and the architecture and those elements.
But also let me say they affect other things too, because in the resolution that says to approve the new City Hall master plan, that's technically, I guess, the next thing, it says the staff team went to mobile workshops to look, and I'm not going to name all these things that they went to, but like Tractor Supply and Snyder Electric, and I know I did look just on the street view of some of these other things too. They don't look anything like what I would be thinking that the outside appearance
right, and
would
that,
look
that's
like.
Not why we went to them.
But
we
see,
went to them to look at the office layout and how a modern office is, it works together and that collaborative space. Mm-hmm. Not to say that's how the outside of our building needs to look, because we understand that the downtown and the square is going to have a different context, but you need to look at how the office functions and how it works, because we're not in a modern facility today.
No, not at all. But
so that's why we visited those facilities.
But the other thing is, you know, one of the concerns that I have is the two big stairways going up, and the opening of the bottom of it, you know, is two stories. In other words, where you don't have, you know, if it's 5,000 square feet, you don't have the 5,000 above it because you've got all this other stuff. So I'm just saying, please, you know, make sure, and also give us a chance to look. Maybe it would be a good idea for us to go out and look at some of these places that have had a lot of impression for the people who are working. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Alderman Berger.
I know when we get these plans and everything, these are placeholders. These are placeholder pictures. They didn't mean nothing to me, because I know that, number one, you better darn well design the internal part to function for our employees. And it better look pretty modern in the fact that it has to function. It doesn't have to, it can look more whatever. It just needs to function, and it needs to function for the future. And we need to have a staircase of some sort prominent, so people can come in and run upstairs and not have to wait on elevators. And people want to use staircases. They shouldn't be in some back hallway. So whatever that looks like. But I think we have to realize that design, you know, comes way later, and functionality is number one for everybody here. And I'm not in the least bit worried about how this place is going to look on the outside, because we're in historic zoning and we have to make sure. But, you know, people do need windows too. And I know, Ann, you know, you said something about the windows, and I agree, but also they're going to have to make sure that they provide those. But I think, you know, sometimes we, and we're all concerned, we all have, you know, questions, and, you know, I don't begrudge anybody that, and any of us, but I think we have to make sure that we've got the horse before the cart on these things, too. You know, so when you guys get ready to really get into design, then that's everybody's gonna have a different opinion, but it's gotta fit on the square. We all know that, and it's gotta function internally.
Mr. Mayor, I just don't want at the end people to say, "Oh, well, we've always shown that." You know.
That's not how it's going to work. No. That's why you've got these, that's why Vernon talked about those multiple checkpoints along the way. So that's what that's designed to do.
It's a very analogous to the funnel, and we're still at the top of it.
Funnel
coming. Analogous.
Reverse pyramid.
A reverse pyramid. That's right. And you'll be making decisions. And that was very intentional when we came to you 2 years ago, that we were just going to take this by pieces and not just say, here, fund the building and go at it.
On the actual item, though, you're asking us to approve the new City Hall master plan.
Yes, because that phase one is complete.
You've completed that phase.
Except for the new programming. Except for the new programming piece of it. Right?
That's part of your schematic design. That's leading into your schematic design.
That'll be a separate PSA that will be coming to you with the scope and service here in a couple, the next meeting or the following meeting.
Were you referring to 22, Alderman Maggie?
Yes.
We were kind of going in between them.
Yes, right. Yeah.
y'all are testing me tonight as far as the timing. I hope y'all aren't planning on another tie vote, but anyway. How about the, is everybody clear on 22, what that is? Okay, so we'll go to 23. Or do we want to just go to 24 and schedule 23 another time? What's best, do you think?
If you would like to do that, we can accommodate that.
What's the desire of the board?
I agree.
We'll just push it back.
Push 23 out to another time.
Yep.
Okay. Michelle, we're sorry.
You're so ready in 2 weeks, though. That's
we're going to do a presentation on an honorary street naming program.
So Mark's going to take you through this, and obviously there's a specific request that came forward related to Justice Clark. But we also want to give you some context, because once you do it, you start a pattern. Yeah. And so we want to give you some things to think about and maybe give us some policy direction that might help as you consider moving forward with this naming and what it might mean for any future consideration or process. So Mark's going to take you through some questions, some things to think about, and then he's even got an example of a sign. But Julian Bibbs here as well, who helped bring this item forward. So, Mark, take it away.
Thank you, Eric. Some staff in Public Works did some research from various communities across the country, taking a look at their honorary street naming programs that they have. We were able to kind of call out a lot of the things that didn't seem to fit here in Franklin, and we have a handful of slides just to quickly run through that talks about different considerations that we want to maybe look at if we want to have a formal street or honorary street naming program. So if we can go to the next slide, Michael, please. So the text is small. I will say that all these photos are in Franklin, by the way, and I stole them off of the communications website. So, the way that the various ordinances that I've looked at is that the honorary street name should be that of an individual or a nonprofit organization. There are some communities that looked at commercial entities, which I don't know that we want to consider that, but that's certainly your decision to do that. The honoree is an individual and must be deceased for a period of no less than 1 year. That was one of the more common ones that I've seen, but there are some state law implications that I think Shauna is trying to weigh in on in the future. But that's a consideration as well. Do we want to have it a five-year period? Pardon me?
But explain the 1 year. It's not like they're coming back.
I think it's just commonly used to just have sort of a time frame that you consider and then make the decision to do a naming.
Okay.
Yep.
I think what Mark was also referring to about the state implications, there was, I think, a piece of legislation that was going to require cities to have a certain waiting period before they did any namings, but I don't know that that's going anywhere in the legislature okay. or not, but it's just something to be aware of that's out there.
Yeah. Thank you, Eric. Another thing that we had seen is that the honoree should have resided in the community or at least worked in the community. There are, in some ordinances, time limits. They have to have lived or resided there for, resided or worked there for a period of 5 years or at least 10 years. So those are some other considerations. And the honoree shall have made a significant positive impact on the community. That is a very, very vague way to, honor somebody, and that decision would fall solely on your shoulders. And does this individual meet that standard? So if we go to the next slide, please, Michael. Some of the guidelines we've seen that they limit the number of designations per year. Does the board want to have one per year or 50 a year? I'm pretty sure you don't want to do 50, but that's just my guess. And then one honorary street sign per intersection. I know we've talked about sign clutter in previous years, and we don't want to have multiple honorary street names on the same block. We don't want the honorary street name to duplicate any road names or come close to any road names that we use for 911 services, et cetera. And the sign request must be made for a publicly owned and maintained roadway. We don't want to get in the business of honorarily naming roads that are private. So, Michael, thank you. So the appearance, there's a number of different ways that communities do this. This is the example that I've kind of written up. This is Cornelia Clark Way, just an example. Julian, can you see that? So Streets Department put this together. We're proposing, if we do this, a blue background with white lettering. Again, this is just a sample for you to get a visual of. My nearsightedness. So they'll be posted above the standard street sign and be the entire length of the roadway. So in the case of Justice Clark, if we look at Fourth Avenue, it would be named the entire way unless there's some site condition that would prevent that from happening. The process, we would request that there is an application process as well as fees to cover the cost of staff and signage and all the other stuff. We would want a letter of consent from heirs or not sure quite how that works, but we don't want to put name or honorary street names of or street signs up of people who whose heirs do not want that to occur. Proposing to have this approved through the board via a resolution, but we'd also want to have the ability to remove the honorary street name sign as well, and again, proposing to do that through a resolution of board approval as well. Handful of additional considerations. There's a lot of communities that limit the number of years that an honorary street name stays in place. 10 years is one that was fairly common. Others didn't limit it at all, but that's something to consider. And then the minimum. A lot of other communities looked at petition processes for all the adjacent properties along the roadway that they're looking to have the signage on. And then again, the minimum amount of time the individual had to be deceased, and that varied all over the place. So just wanted to kind of point out some of those considerations as we start drafting some language if we want to go in that direction. I'd love to hear your feedback tonight, and assuming we want to go down this path, start drafting an ordinance to amend municipal code. I assume that's the way we would want to go. I'm looking over at Shauna. Yes. And bring it back to you for specific comment on ordinance language. So with that, I'd love to hear any thoughts.
I thought that we had said it would not necessarily be the entire length of the subject street, because I think that could be a real problem. And won't it be changing everybody who lives on that street?
This is an honorary naming, so it doesn't change the street address.
Okay. It doesn't really change the street address. Yeah.
Yeah. Sorry, okay. I wasn't clear.
So there's no implications for that.
So then would you put up the honorary thing on every intersection of the street?
That would be the idea, yes. And it's the board's option to limit where that...
You could do a segment of a street if you wanted to. I mean, in the case of what we're considering for Justice Clark is a fairly short stint on 4th Avenue. So. Correct.
Alderman Berger?
Yeah, I was just wondering if a shorter area would be more appropriate. That answered my question about making sure we weren't... that they would keep their same address.
Yes.
Okay, so if it was, you know, Tulip Tree Road, it would still be Tulip Tree Road.
It would be, yes.
Their address, okay. And when you talk about term limit designation, in other words, you might put it up there and say, we'll do it for 10 years, mm-hmm. but would you do that up front, or would you just, it be open-ended, or would you have a limit on it? Do people do that in other...
A lot of communities do that. I think the most common I had seen, if there was a limit, was 10 years. I've seen 5 years. I think there was a few that were even shorter.
And then if a board wanted to renew it, they could renew it.
You could roll it over.
They could renew it.
Yeah, they wouldn't necessarily have to take it down. If you said it was for 10 years, mm-hmm. and then a new board came in at 10 years, said, no, we want to renew it.
It would have to be a deliberate action.
There's nothing that says you cannot do that. Okay.
And that's up to you how you all want to do it. You're kind of helping us set a policy here. That's one issue we saw was the idea of doing a time frame that, again, you could renew or you can just make it ongoing.
And what's permanent. The petition process mean? What's that?
So
how does that work?
There is a number of communities, and not all of them, require that the applicant go through a petition process or have the city go through a petition process for all the properties adjacent to the subject road. So if you have 15 property owners along, we'll just use 4th Avenue as the example, you'd have to have a simple majority or other majority that you all deem necessary in order for that honorary street name to move forward.
I don't understand why that would be necessary if we're not changing their address. Because I would think that's pretty mind-boggling. You would end up with everybody and every... And if you're changing their address, I can see that, mm-hmm. absolutely. Right. But if we're not changing their address, I don't see a need for that.
I don't disagree. This is something that was pretty common in the research that we had done, so I wanted
to see why they would do it.
Put it out there. So thank you.
Alderman Baggett, then I've got the vice mayor.
I think this is fantastic. I would not want to subject Justice Clark to anyone of stature, you know, to go through a process unduly. But I do think that there's some subjectivity here in the criteria.
Yes.
And sounds kind of like commission work, frankly, like the historic zoning, like to provide a recommendation. Are we going to, I mean, there's, I guess I could put in an application to name a street after my wife after she, Lord willing, Amy, I know you're watching. I got nothing planned, but where's the chief? But really, I guess if a husband, let's say hypothetically, could submit an application, and then, so I think there needs to be some kind of review of maybe the historic impact of the individual, some of these subjectivity things, and that we don't spend time in a work session deliberating over the historic significance. We get a recommendation from maybe the Historic Zoning Commission, or I don't know if there's a better option, but. Who took some time maybe to look at the historic nature of the individual to then go honorarily name a street. The other thing was we couldn't have named MLK, I guess, after Martin Luther under one of these.
Well, in that case, you renamed the street.
The whole street.
It was an honorary street renaming.
Okay, got it. Okay.
And in that case, you had limited, there was no address changes.
Just I don't want to muck up the process, but I do think it would be, I don't know if we need to, anyway, the commission's recommendation might be
helpful to determine those historic significant individuals that would...
Yeah, the communities that we looked at, typically the application would help guide that and provide the documentation that this person had a significant impact in some form or fashion. That's again, it's up to the board on how you want to approach it. I'm wide open and happy to draft language that you see that y'all can consider in a future meeting. So that's an interesting idea to think about. So thank you.
Vice Mayor, you got the last word.
I know, you want me to
word.
Make it quick. I know. Thank you, Mark, for all this work and whoever else helped you. I'm sure you had help. I think 10 years is, the older we get, 10 years is a blink of an eye. I think it is to me. I think 10 years is a little bit small of a window. I don't know that what arbitrary number we want to pull out, but if you think about the honor for it to last only 10 years, mm-hmm. to me, why did we bother? For the moment in time. I also think that we do need to kind of set like a, we can't be doing this every month. Mm-hmm. I don't know that one is appropriate. I don't know if we do a range. But I think Patrick's got a good point that it doesn't need to be us trying to be deciding who our favorite person is that we want a blue sign in Franklin for. So, and maybe there needs to be not only a range of tenure, but there needs to be a range of area mm-hmm. so that we're not having every 16 block of downtown Franklin having blue signs. Mm-hmm. So, first
Paul Holzen has requested to name his roadway. So.
He's still alive, though. One thing to look at that might be a good example is what we do with Public Art Commission. They review and make a recommendation. It comes to you.
Yeah.
We have incorporated a public, not like a formal public hearing, but we've done a public meeting with it that gives the public some additional chance to comment on it. We just sort of naturally built that in the process in the last year or so. So that might be an example. I think the idea of using some kind of commission might make some sense as a vetting, as an alternative to the petition. It gives you something to sort of have some other folks look at it and give you some feedback. So, and then having some open process for the public to give you feedback is good too. Mm-hmm.
And this could be through the whole city. This
could
is
be
not,
anywhere.
This is not just downtown.
Right.
No, not necessarily.
It should be the whole city. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Thank you.
10 after. We'll try to do 10 after.